Here's the latest project I've been working on. It's a digital IC tester designed to identify and test and allow the manual manipulation of digital ICs such as 4000 and 7400 series. The unit has a 24-pin zero insertion force socket, and the device supports testing chips between 14 and 24 pins. And that shows you how to orient the chip in the socket. It can be used in identify mode, where you just tell it how many pins there are on the chip and it will go and try to identify it by manipulating its inputs and controls, and then evaluating the outputs to see whether they match a known chip type. Alternatively, you can run the test function where you tell it what chip number you've got in there, and it then will exercise the chip and test it. And then you can manually manipulate the chip as well if you wish. The IC tester is based on an item I found on instructables.com, and it's called IC tester, and it's by a guy called Akshay Bawadji, or Bawedja. I'm not sure how to pronounce that, so apologies if I get it wrong. I've added lots of additional functionality to the software, and I've expanded the ZIF socket from 16 to 24 pins. I've also added quite a few things to the database, and at the moment there are 182 chips supported, 61 of which have got full definitions for their pins, numbering, and that sort of thing, and I've expanded various test cases, so it's quite a bit updated. I'll put a link to Akshay's Instructables site down in the text. I've placed a 7400 chip in the socket, so I'm going to use identify mode to try to see what that is, even though we know. How many pins has it got? Well, it's got 14. So it's now running through its database, and it's found 7400, 7403, 74132, 7426, 7437, and in total it found 6 different matches. So this chip behaves like 6 different chips, but as you can see, all of them are quad 2 input NAND gates. So if we pick this one, it goes and looks up the definition of the 7400, retests it, tells us that it's good. And for the 7400, there are 4 test cases. This is showing case 1 of 4, where these are the values that have either been applied to the chip or are expected in terms of outputs responses from the chip. So this is pin 1, which is here. This is pin 14, which is there. So in this case, we've got ground on pin 7. We've got VCC on pin 14. The test applies a 0 and a 0 to the inputs of the NAND gate and expects a high, and it does that for all 4 gates that are on this chip. So if we run to the next test, that applies 1 to each of the inputs on each of the NAND gates, and again we get a high output, which is what you'd expect. It's then swapped over the inputs and made a different one high and the other one low, and again we've got a high. And the final test to prove that all the gates are behaving is that both inputs on each gate are set high and the outputs are low, which is what you would expect. So this IC 7400 is good. If we want to look at a more detailed version of the chip and potentially manually manipulate it, we can go into the detail option. Right, so here we've got the chip in the center with pin 1 up here, pin 14, pin 7 and pin 8. Inputs and outputs to the chip and different control signals are identified by different symbols. So inward pointing arrows are inputs, that's these ones here. Outputs are outward pointing arrows. VCC is a red square, ground is a black square, and for things like clock signals and other enable, clear, reset, all those sorts of things, there are other symbols that will be used on the chip. On the outside, we've got the current way that the input is being driven, where the downward pointing arrow being low and an upward pointing arrow being high, and we've got the current state of the outputs with a filled in circle being high and an outline circle being low. each of the inputs and outputs to the chip and the pin symbols is shown in a different colour for each element on the chip. So this is a four element chip with four NAND gates. So if we would have a dual counter, then we would have some pins outlined, say, in magenta and some outlined in yellow. And that allows us to see which pins relate to which element of the chip. So if we actually step through the test cases now, this is showing we're on test case 1 of 4, which we saw previously, again with both inputs being low and the output being high for each gate. So step through the test cases, we now get a more graphical view of things, and there we've got both inputs being high and all the outputs being low. So as well as doing that, we can actually manipulate the inputs and observe the outputs. So if I, let's say, wanted to put this output low, then what I can do is I can tap on it on the diagram, and it will then switch to manual mode. And because in manual mode we'll be manipulating inputs and controls, then the state of the output is irrelevant until we apply those changes. So there we go, we've moved to manual mode. That input has now gone low. All of the outputs have been hidden, so we don't get confused. So we'll leave that one low, we'll put these two low, and we'll put this one low, and the test button is now lit up. So we can hit the test button, and it applies those inputs and controls to the chip, and then shows us the state of the outputs. So to switch back to normal mode, we just hit the init button, and we're back to showing the first of the four test cases. And in this case, all of the inputs on each of the gates are manipulated in the same way for each set of four test cases. So all low, one high, one low, all high, and all low outputs. So that partially checks the chip, but it doesn't potentially check for any interconnecting issues between the different lines. So the manual mode allows us to do whatever we want with the chip. So I can do that, and I can do that. And we've now got different inputs and outputs on the various gates, and we can prove that the gate does, that the chip does what we expect it to do. Now inserted a 72241 into the ZIF socket, so we'll do an identify. It's a 20-pin chip. It's found it. 74241 octal buffer and line driver tri-state. So I'll select that. Says it's good. So let's go and look at the details of this chip. Right, we've got two different colours on here, which shows us that even though it's an octal buffer, there are actually two 4-bit parts to this chip. We've got an enable line here that is active low, as indicated by the overscore, and also by the circle on the chip pin. So the controls are always shown as squares and can be manipulated, unless it's a clock, which we'll come to shortly. So in this case, the enable zero, the enable line is low, which is active, and the other gate, set of gates rather, their enable signal is active high, and that's high, so they're active. So at the moment, we've got input 1, input 2, input 3, input 4 in magenta, output 4, 3, 2, 1, also in magenta, and then the inputs for the yellow element are on this side with the outputs on this side. So if we go and manipulate, let's say, this input and this input and this input, then we would expect output 1, output 3, and output 4 to go high. So hit the test button, and that's what we get. And if we go and manipulate some of the other elements of the chip, so we'll do 1 and 4, right, and do the test, and those outputs go high, and the outputs for 2 and 3 stay low. Now, as this is a tri-state chip, and the tester applies a pull-up resistor to the line, if, let's say, we just clear all of the inputs down to 0, apply the test, all the outputs have gone to 0. So if we set the enable pin on this element of the chip, which is active low, and we set it high, that then will put the outputs all into tri-state mode, so they should all go high. So all the outputs in the purple element should all go high. That's this one, and this one. And there they are. And likewise, if we actually put the enable to line low and hit the test key, then all the outputs on the yellow element also go high. So this chip seems to be working just fine. I'll now put a 7442 in the tester, so we can do a test. 7442. It goes and finds the chip definition in the database. Oh, it says this one is bad. It's a 1 of 10 inverting decoder demultiplexer. And here's the first test case. So it's a 16-pin chip, VCC and ground. Now we'll go into the detail view straight away, which gives us a better overview of what the chip does and what pins do what. So in this case, we've got four input pins, 1, 2, 4, and 8. We've got 10 output pins from 0 to 9, and with this decoder demultiplexer, the binary number presented on the inputs selects which output is sent low. So here we've got 0000, which gives us output 0, and if we walk through the test cases, then test case 2 shows us with input 1 high, therefore output 1 goes high. Next test case, input 2 goes high, so output 2 goes high. Next one, input 1 and 2 are high, which is a binary representation of 3, so output 3 goes high. Right, and everything seems to be fine. So there we've got output 7 is high because inputs 1, 2 and 4 are high. But on the when we get test case 10, we've got input 8 high with inputs 4 and 2 and 1 low, and output 8 would be expected to be high, but it's highlighted. Sorry, output 8 would be expected to be low, but it's highlighted because it's high, and output 0 has gone low even though it's expected to be high. So this gate is actually, sorry, this IC is actually faulty. And if we go on to the next final test case where we've got an input on 8, a high input on 8 and 1, and output 9 would be expected to be low, it's high, and output 1 is low. So this shows us that this is a faulty 7442 chip. Not sure how I blew it up, but it's obviously broken. So let's now put the a good 7442 in and have a look at that. I've now swapped the 7442 for a good one. And I could go back to the main menu and choose the chip number again, but because we're already on a 7442, I can just hit the init button. That goes back to test 1 of 10. We can then step through the defined test cases. So we're expecting the inputs to climb from 0 to 9, and we're expecting the outputs to go low, each one in turn, from 0 to 9. So we'll do that this time with this different 7442. And that's how the thing should behave. So, one good 7442, one duff one. I've now put a 74595 chip in the ZIF socket. So if we do a test on that, 74595, oh, oops, I just showed you the backspace key works and the clear key, 74595. I really must speed this up. It's a good one. Okay, so it's an 8-bit tri-state serial in parallel out shift register. And just to explain a couple of things here. In this case, some of the outputs are set to don't care, which is why they've got no status on them. We've got a standard input here, which is the serial input. We've got an enable, which is shown as a square on the chip, and it's an active low, so it's got the circle on it and the overscore. We're going to reset, which is also active low, so it's also got a circle and an overscore. And the things like reset and clear have got a semicircle as the indicator on the chip. And we've also got two clocks here, and both these clocks at the moment are in a low state. Now, if for each step on a test case or for a manual test, I want to actually just pulse that clock, all I do is select it like that, and we've now moved back into manual mode, and we've got a positive pulse will be applied to that pin when we press the test key. Now, if I press it again, it goes to a high level. Press it again, it goes to a low level, or I can press it again and it goes back to a pulse. So that's an explanation of how the clocks work. Right, that's a quick overview of the modified IC tester. Let me know if you have any suggestions or other comments. Bye.